So I think we'll get going. I'm really kind of excited about this webinar, as I always am, but this one in particular for a lot of reasons. One of the things is I see people showing up. We've got a different mix, and I'm also really happy to see Mark Whitlock present. And you'll learn more about Mark during this session. But our topic today is The Eden Conspiracy. And it's a book that was written originally, as you'll learn, by Joe Harless quite a few years ago, but then republished by the Cambridge Center for Behavioral Studies a few years ago. And I think represents a really powerful, fully demonstrated, and extremely important solution to some current problems. And in fact, before we launch into it, and I've got a little bit of preliminary stuff to talk about before we get into the session, but I think if we just stop for a moment and reflect on the current sort of situation in education and in jobs, employment, and in particular in college debt these days, there's some very interesting challenges. And I think you'll see as I sort of unpack the story about the Eden Conspiracy and the amazing program that it spawned and has been running for more than 2 decades, the Central Educational Center, that this offers a really important solution. I should also mention that the book, which I'll direct you to how to purchase, is a bargain at $19.95. But think about it. First of all, we have enormous college debt in this country. And the cost of college has caused many, many young people and their parents to sort of hesitate and be concerned about the value of a college degree. And I by no means am trying to discount the value of a college degree. But I think we also have to recognize that there's a lack of skilled employees in many, many parts of the world, at least in the United States. I have a contractor who's been working on building and refurbishing houses since he was 14, and he's, I think, 75 or 76, older than I am. And he always is talking about the fact that it's hard to find skilled electricians, plumbers, builders of various kinds. And there are many other areas where it's hard to find people who are skilled. So employees have a challenge too, employers and employees. So there's a whole bunch of issues, and I think you'll see that this book, and again, the program, the model that it's spawned, can maybe offer important solutions. Now, before we go on, I just want to recognize coincidentally that today is the anniversary of Tom Gilbert's passing. Tom and his wife, Marilyn, were really important mentors to me. I met Tom very early on, and in fact, this picture is from a workshop that I arranged in Boston back in about 1985, when I was president of the ISPI, International Society for Performance Improvement chapter in Massachusetts. But Tom passed in 1995, and as you'll see, he was a very important contributor. And those of you who know about our work recognize the sort of foundation that he laid, that Joe Harless followed up on. And also, though, Marilyn, because Marilyn was an extraordinary writer and editor, and she only passed this last May. She was almost 100 years old and still very active, and she was a friend of mine for years. And probably without her contribution as editor and writer, the book Human Competence, which has affected so many people, would not have been written. So I just want to offer sort of this recognition of the Gilberts, who were my mentors and I think made an important contribution. Now, just a second here. One of the things that I should mention is I think most of you know, or many of you know, that we post our webinars on our YouTube channel at performancethinking.tv. We also have some short videos and playlists there. And so check it out. And also, as our webinar list has grown, we've been doing this for almost 3 years. This is, I believe, the 35th of our monthly free webinars. You can use the QR code there to get to a mailing list that you can fill out, because we've begun to develop free webinar study guides for groups and individuals who want to study these webinars in more detail. And so if you're interested, either here and now, or when the recording becomes available and you get your notice of the recording being posted, you can use this QR code in your phone to sign up for our free study guides as they come out. And of course, this is going to be recorded and put on YouTube. So if you're watching it on YouTube, please subscribe. Please like and share this work. We're really trying to get it out to as many people as we can. And I know many of the folks here have colleagues and friends and so forth who can who might be interested. And we've also, as usual, we want to kind of mention we've got more webinars coming. We as you'll see today, the background of performance thinking and performance improvement really goes back to Skinner's Natural Science of Behavior. And I talk about that a lot in webinars and programs that we offer, but we're going to have a session devoted to sort of the nerdy end of that a little bit at some point. What good looks like is a topic related to defining expectations, really, of what good accomplishments are. And I'll talk about that a little bit more in a minute. We'll be talking about sales enablement and fluent performance and lots of other topics, but we've got plenty to talk about in the future. Now, the upcoming one next October 25th is, in fact, going to be titled What Does Good Look Like? And some of you who've been through our programs know that we talk about accomplishments or work outputs, and then we talk about criteria for good outputs. What makes a good one? A good proposal, a good decision, a good relationship, a good widget, whatever the output is. How do we define goodness? Now, it's probably fairly obvious to people that you need to have criteria, but people don't always do a good job of this. And I want to talk a little bit about sort of the technical elements of that, and also what the implications are for management, for training, for feedback, and so forth. And you, if you're not registered for all of our webinars, you can go to the homepage at performancethinking.com, and there's a little thing that says register for free webinars, and you can sign up for the notices. So this is kind of an overview of the topics I want to talk about today. And then I do hope to have some conversation at the end. But I want to talk about a little bit about the evolution of accomplishment-based performance improvement and really our version of it, which we call performance thinking. Just want to talk a little bit about that. And then I want to speak about accomplishment-based curriculum development, which was perhaps one of, if not the most important contribution that Dr. Joe Harless made that we've adopted, but led to his book, The Eden Conspiracy, which is about accomplishment-based education and is the topic or the focus of this session. And then its legacy, which is the Central Educational Center in Noonan, Georgia, the CEO of whom, which is present with us today. So I hope we can grab Mark, his comments in the chat box if I miss anything or if there's some additional things to be said. And the book was republished by the Cambridge Center for Behavioral Studies, which I think is an important thing because it sort of made the leap from the field of performance improvement back to its roots in behavior science and one of the principal organizations worldwide that promotes the application of behavior science. And then talk a little bit. Hopefully we'll have some questions and discussion. So there's a scientific lineage here, and I'm part of it, but I'm not the person on the in the pictures here. These men were extraordinary contributors, and they were all my mentors and teachers, and each one made an important contribution. Dr. Skinner was really my first teacher in behavior science. I studied with him at Harvard, but from his work, I wound up doing educational work and then eventually performance improvement. And when I started in performance improvement in the early 80s, I read Tom Gilbert's book, Human Competence, and I reached out to him, and he was a mentor and friend to me for some years and certainly a huge contributor. Dr. Joe Harless was Tom's protege, and he was actually knew Dr. Gilbert when Gilbert was a professor at the University of Alabama, and Joe was an undergraduate tutoring football players so they could stay on the team and be the national champions if possible. And Joe took the ideas, the concepts, the contributions of Gilbert and really standardized and packaged them in a way that was replicable. And they both used to talk a lot about the educational revolution. Now, they made their living in corporate environments and business environments and government organizations where they did performance improvement. But they always talked about getting back to the educational revolution. And that's what Dr. Harless did after he retired and wrote The Eden Conspiracy. So we can start with Skinner's lab. And there's a few of you I can see in the list who are trained as behavior scientists. And if you weren't, it's not a big deal. It doesn't matter too much. But a lot of the work that Dr. Skinner did in his laboratory was with pigeons. He also worked with rats and some other organisms. But pigeons, because they're pretty darn smart, because they were pretty easy to work with, because they had good visual discrimination and so forth, were very convenient organisms to work with in basic research. And this kind of rough graphic that I pulled off the web is a kind of a picture of an operant conditioning chamber from Dr. Skinner's lab and from many labs around the world that kind of were spawned by his original research in the 20s and 30s and subsequent years. And people think of it as involving continuous measurement of behavior. So, you know, are we counting key pecks? What we have in there is a pigeon who pecks the key that's right in front of him and on some sort of schedule gets paid off for doing so. But as Ogden Lindsley pointed out to me many years ago, it's actually the switch closure that makes the difference. Because the pigeon could conceivably peck that key not hard enough or at the wrong angle or in a glancing blow, so that maybe it didn't actually close the switch. But the closure of the switch or the closed switch is what leads to the food being delivered to the pigeon. So even in Skinner's operant conditioning laboratory, there were accomplishments. The accomplishments were the switch closure. So I think that's kind of interesting for those of us who are behavior scientists. Now, if you fast forward to Gilbert, worked briefly in postdoc kind of relationship with Dr. Skinner, because he was basically in education. But Dr. Skinner, when he moved into human application, started the Office of Program Instruction. Holland and Skinner, and a number of really important contributors were part of that. And in fact, program instruction ultimately led to performance improvement. And Tom was at Harvard for a short time. And then subsequently, he wrote his famous book, Human Competence. And in that book, he made the rather outrageous statement. And one of the things about Gilbert, he was a bit of an iconoclast. He liked to get people's attention. He liked to kind of poke people in the eye a little bit. But he said, in the great cult of behavior, behavior itself is viewed as an end rather than as a means to an end. Just about everybody that's present here has probably heard me read that because I read it all the time. And I also always want to make the point that he wasn't talking about behaviorists or behavior scientists. He was talking about everybody. He was pointing out that as educators, trainers, leaders, managers, you name it, we tend to focus on activity or the behavior of people. But as he pointed out, if we're going to make a difference in organizations or with people or in society, for that matter, we must enable people to produce accomplishments, the valuable products of behavior. So he introduced this idea, which was an enormous paradigm shift from a focus on behavior and behavioral objectives and organizational behavior management and leadership behavior, et cetera, to the products of that behavior. Now, I've had a lot of conversations with people about this over the years, and it's a hard thing for people to understand sometimes, but this is one of my favorite ways to get people to understand what we're talking about here, because I'll bet you've been in a meeting that failed to produce any valuable accomplishments. This was actually something that came up in a conversation with my colleague and friend, Brett DeNovi, some years ago, when he was a really good behaviorist and organizational behavior management guy. And he was saying, after I'd introduced this accomplishment-based approach to him, he said, so tell me again why accomplishments are important. Why do you focus on that? And I just said, Brett, have you ever been in a meeting that failed to produce any valuable accomplishments? And of course, we always have. We all have, I mean. And that's why you have good agendas, if the agendas tell you what you're supposed to accomplish. At the end of this meeting, what do we want to do? Well, we want to make the following decisions. We want to have some agreed-upon action steps, whatever it is. But meetings are valuable to the extent they produce something, which might even be just relationships. But whatever it is, there's a value to a meeting if there are accomplishments. Now, Joe Harless, as I mentioned, was an undergraduate student with with Tom Gilbert at the University of Alabama, and he eventually went on and got a PhD. And he, in fact, had he at one point he worked with Tom Gilbert, and they were both important pioneers in the field of human performance improvement. And Joe wrote a book in 1975, published a book called "An Ounce of Analysis is Worth a Pound of Objectives," and I've always loved the title mostly. Now, this book is probably out of date in many, many ways, and it's probably not available except as a used book anymore. But it really was the precursor to Harless's subsequent work on what he called front-end analysis, which I'll talk about in a minute. But he talked about front-end analysis here. He coined that phrase. It's like what you do at the front end of a performance improvement project. You do some analysis. And the notion that some analysis, an ounce of analysis, is highly valuable is perhaps obvious to people, but it's stunning how often people launch into projects, whether they're training projects or performance improvement projects, really just thinking they know what the intervention ought to be. And this was an early part of Joe's work, which is really defining what it means to do front-end analysis in an accomplishment-based way. And in fact, he had a series of programs that he eventually put together and commercialized and delivered. And I went through all of his programs, but he also implemented them in big companies that would certify people to deliver them. And his FEA, front-end analysis program, was a really important one of those. Now, fast forward to the work that we do in the Performance Thinking Network. We've basically followed on the model that Gilbert sort of came up with conceptually, focus on accomplishments, and then Harless refined. And we use this simple picture we call the performance chain, where we point out that, if you work backwards, you're trying to achieve some societal or organizational or business result. In order to do that, you deliver or enable people to produce accomplishments, what we call work outputs, because we think it's a useful technical term, but it's also easy to understand. And it's only then that you can define the behavior and all the things you do to produce that behavior. So this is the way we think about the elements of performance. And as I've already mentioned, we anchor all of this to accomplishments. Now, just as a footnote, many of you, again, that are in this gathering know about the phrase work outputs, but we coined that term some years ago, probably 15, 20 years ago, because when we spoke to our colleagues about accomplishments, they had very fuzzy definitions of what they actually meant. Sometimes they meant organizational level results, which we don't think of as outputs. We think of them as an aggregate effect or impact of accomplishments. And sometimes they talked about small things and everything in between. So we coined the phrase work outputs as an equivalent to accomplishments. And what's built into that phrase is that it's a product of something, work, in a business environment, at least, or work environment, and it can be plural. It's countable things. So this is another way to think about it. Those people who have been through our programs are familiar with our famous soccer girl. And what we point out is in athletics and every place else, we behave, we engage in some sort of action. And if we're successful, we produce a thing. In this case, it's a goal. The ball in the net is the thing that young lady is trying to produce. And why do we care? Well, because it contributes to, in this case, winning the game, the organizational or team results. So that's, again, those are the elements of performance. We really have embedded in our work Gilbert's, two things of Gilbert. One is this focus on work outputs or accomplishments. And then when it gets to all the things that influence behavior, one of the things that I did in the late 80s was, because his original behavior engineering model was brilliant, had the same six kind of cells as we have in what we now call the six boxes model, but the terminology for it was often hard for people to understand. So I spent about 5 years with my colleagues trying different language for the cells of the model until we came up with language that we could test with people. They'd understand it pretty quickly. It didn't make category errors and so forth. So this guides our approach to performance analysis. And I go through this sort of overview of our approach just so you understand why we're even talking about an accomplishment-based approach to education, because I see what Harless did is he took this methodology that Tom conceptually created, Joe Harless packaged, and we've continued to refine in some ways into education. Now, here it just happens to be an example in a business environment of what accomplishments or outputs might look like for, in this case, a vice president of marketing and sales in a high-tech startup. This person or this role delivers accomplishments or outputs to the different customers or stakeholders that are circled around the job title. And we can also do this for processes. We can define accomplishments or outputs wherever we find them, and that's usually the beginning of a project. Now, what Harless introduced in a really big way was what he called accomplishment-based curriculum development. And if you think about it, in fact, he used to sort of joke about this a little bit, because Bob Mager was his good friend, and he was also a friend of mine, but those guys were more, they were sort of a half generation older than I was. And at our conferences at the International Society for Performance Improvement, Harless and Mager were always sort of giving each other a hard time. And of course, Bob Mager was very well known for, among other things, behavioral objectives. And what Joe Harless pointed out was, as in any other environment, as Tom Gilbert pointed out, accomplishments are what are valuable. So the approach to instructional design or curriculum development that Harless took looked something like this. You'd say, here's a job title. Here's the accomplishments or the outputs that they need to produce. And then here's the tasks, steps, in other words, the behavior for producing them. And you could turn that into a curriculum which was built around accomplishments and behavior, but leading with, organized by accomplishments. And so that was what Joe Harless took into companies, and he had what he called his ABCD system, which was a very extensive, thoroughly job-aided, consistently effective approach that was adopted by a lot of companies. That is just a few of the logos. The Coast Guard still honors Joe Harless. They adopted ABCD decades ago, but he's still very prominent in their world. Boeing, which is, I know pretty well because they're in my vicinity and I grew up in the Seattle area and they were originally based in Seattle. Boeing was a big adopter. Bell South, which used to be a separate entity before it was combined into, I think, AT&T, Consumer Energy, FedEx, and many other companies adopted and certified people to deliver and trained people in the ABCD methodology. Now, when Joe retired, this was what his legacy was in the corporate or business or organizational performance improvement world. But as I mentioned, he and Tom Gilbert had always been talking about the educational revolution. Like, how could they take what we knew from behavior science and, you know, change it into something that would change and affect education? And so when he retired, he began to write a book that became The Eden Conspiracy. And he published it in 1998. And I was involved in a second publication of it in 2017, because frankly, in the early 2000s, I often would recommend this book to my friends and colleagues, and we couldn't get any more. And I contacted Carol Harless, because Joe by that time had passed away, and she said there were none available anymore. They were out of stock. So Carol and I and a number of other people who I'll mention worked together to get it republished in 2017 through the Cambridge Center for Behavioral Studies. But the point is that Joe began to write this book, and it's kind of a philosophy book, but it also is a book about how to do it, what it would look like if our educational system was focused on developing accomplished citizens. And this is the table of contents. If you get the book, you can sort of see it. It's an interesting mix of sort of philosophy and technology, if you will. But one of the things that Joe was doing in the last few years when he was working in the corporate world, because I used to see him a lot at conferences and I spoke with him a lot on the phone, he would ask people for a successful, accomplished citizen, what are important accomplishments of them? And so you can see this list, things like a savings account, you know, purchasing decision within budget, job application, clean teeth without cavities, a driver's license. These are all things that you can accomplish as a citizen. One of my favorite one, it isn't written down that way here, but was informed reproductive decisions. I think he has family planning decisions in here. So this is some examples that he was starting to accumulate about what we need to prepare young people to produce, to be able to achieve or produce when they finish their schooling. And then here's some vocational accomplishments. These are all things, many of these are in things like surgical kit ready for the operating room, accurate measures of weight and size. These are things which people in various vocational environments need to be able to produce. And, you know, when you do an analysis of someone's job, you come up with things like this. And then you can look at examples of accomplishments in an educational environment too, like words that are properly spelled, you know, essays, reports, drawings. Robots, if you happen to be taking a robotic course, et cetera. So there's a whole lot of stuff. And in fact, some of these are examples of outputs or accomplishments of students in the Central Educational Center, which I'll be mentioning shortly. And so this is shortly. So this is kind of a timeline. When Joe retired, he sold his business programs to Paul Elliott, who eventually created Exemplary Performance and is now a sort of a senior person related to that, although it's being run by another person now. But he decided to return to the educational revolution. And he published The Eden Conspiracy. But while he was working on the book, business people, especially and educators, people from where he lived, which was Noonan, Georgia, which is not a very long drive out of Atlanta, where Joe had the biggest house in town and he was well regarded already by the community. They said, you know, our businesses are not getting graduates from the local high school who can work here. They're not preparing us, you know, they're not preparing people that can work in our companies. And so they reached out to Joe asking him if he could help. And you can read about the details in the book, but essentially what happened is he put together this task force that included business people, educators, politicians, policymakers, parents, students, et cetera, together. And over a period of time, they basically put together this plan, which was a joint venture between the local businesses, the local technical college, and the high school or the school system. And they created a place called the Central Educational Center, and they opened their doors. And it's a unique program, or certainly was when it was begun, in that it combined secondary and post-secondary education, adult education, and was very quickly chosen as a model for educational reform. And a few years later, it was named one of the 30 replicable national high school reform models by the International Center for Leadership and Education. And a lot more has happened since then. And I'm not up to date on everything because a lot has developed over subsequent years. But this thing went from concept to real program over a fairly short period of time. And these are the two players. And Mark is with us today. Mark is an extraordinary leader, I will have to say. And I think he was kind of hand-picked by Joe, because as they put this thing together, first of all, notice it's called CEO. His job title is CEO. He's not principal of the school. He's the CEO of this program. And a whole lot of other people participated. But Mark has this unique background of having been an international banker, a business guy, and brought in to head up this effort, and has been doing it brilliantly for, you know, well over two decades now. And so these two men were, you know, basically led the development and the continued evolution of this thing. But I should mention that when we decided to try to republish the book through the Cambridge Center for Behavioral Studies, I visited the Central Educational Center, and I got to know Mark a little bit, and I did a tour. And one evening, he and Carol Harless took me to a gathering, which was put on by a local business guy. And it was a classic sort of Southern barbecue type of gathering of the community, you know, and the community leaders in this relatively small town were all there. And I was introduced to them. Everybody knew who Joe Harless was. Everybody, you know, praised and had wonderful things to say about the Central Educational Center. And many of them were on the task force. So it was a community effort. And I think that's really important. Some things about the center. This is kind of old data, and I think Mark could probably update us on it. But it was there was a steering committee that engaged a whole lot of other people. The curriculum really was focused on what are we going to enable our high school age students to produce, to achieve, with a focus on being able to successfully work at local companies, but also to be successful citizens. And they used the ADDIE model, the Analysis, Design, Development, Implementation, Evaluation model, as an underlying sort of approach. They integrated across high school, post-secondary, and adult education training so that students spent a lot of time on the job in their various companies in a whole lot of different areas. They developed active partnerships with local companies and local organizations. Things like the local TV station building a full-on TV studio in the building of the Central Education Center. I was actually videoed in it, but I mean, these kids taught by a person who was a professional manager of video and film production in company for a long time. But they put on a real TV show. I mean, they actually do the real work. This isn't just pretend. And there were a lot of other examples like that of partnership and investments. Again, it was led by a CEO with business experience, Mark Whitlock. And it focuses on technical education. But one of the things Joe wanted to do, and this is part of the reason for encouraging people to read the book, Harless really wanted to extend this to general education. In other words, his view was that the educational system, whether it's for kindergartners or, you know, older people, ought to be focused on what people can accomplish, not just on so-called content. And many of you involved in the performance improvement world know this is one of the problems in companies also, that you can't just focus on content. What is it people can produce at the end of it? Now, a lot has happened since I wrote these bullet points a few years ago and then just tweaked them recently. But this program has been replicated across a lot of different places, both funded to be replicated across Georgia, but also people from other states and other countries have expressed interest and engaged with them over the last 25 years. Now, this is just a slide that I pulled off of the Central Education Center website. But these are, you can see around that circle, these are career fields. These are things in the region where graduates of this program are prepared to get jobs. And you can see these are not just sort of cleaning the streets and serving tables. These are computer technology, construction, industrial maintenance, you know, stuff that represents potentially high earning levels and professional development without a full-on college degree required. So that's what the program was preparing people for, the accomplishments required to be successful in those kind of settings. It was originally funded, and there's a lot more to say, and I've got a link to the replication guide that was produced by the CEC, but it was originally funded from the local community, plus some money from the state of Georgia. An enormous amount of investments have been made by the companies, like Yamaha, you know, 300 jobs, Cancer Treatments Centers of America, if I recall, established a center there because they knew they could hire people that could fill the jobs. Kia, if I recall, upgraded their factory automations because now they had young people who could work there. One of the cool things, and this is when I visited a few years ago before republishing the book, was that there were both Democratic and Republican politicians who were highly supportive. It was definitely across the aisle kind of thing. The Senate codified and funded replications across Georgia. And I think this number is probably quite obsolete, but at the time there were well over 200 employer sites where students were actually serving in internship and apprentice kind of, you know, situations. And then there were visits from all over the place. One of the things is, and, you know, the current economy is kind of a funny place, but the graduates earn an average starting salary of around 40 grand a year, which is a pretty good salary in Georgia. Now, here's a statement from the National Center for Educational Evaluation and Regional Assistance back in 2011, where they said, conceptually, it's based on the model described by Harless in the Eden Conspiracy. Harless's model stresses high expectations, advanced technical training combined with more rigorous academic instruction than typical vocational education, hands-on projects, flexibility for students to determine their post-high school paths, integration of secondary, post-secondary education, et cetera. So this was recognized as a unique and pretty darn powerful thing even back more than 10 years ago. Now, when I visited, I met a few students. Mark Whitlock introduced me to a few students, and there were just three that I can remember. But, you know, I don't know how many of you have been to high schools recently. And most, okay, so Mark just added more than 300 employer sites today. Fair enough. So I remember these three students in particular. I remember a young fellow who got involved in the course, which was on robotics. And he went on to college. He went to Georgia Tech and later, as I understand it, went to the MIT Media Lab. Now, this was years ago, but this isn't just a vocational training program. This is a program that can also accelerate kids' progress into good college and universities if they want to go in that direction. There was a young lady that just blew my mind. She, I think, was maybe 15 when I met her. And I was in a seminar when she came into the room. And she was dressed to the nines, man. She had her business suit on. She had her makeup and her hair was good and everything. And I learned that there's a really robust film and video program at the CEC. And she was an in front of the camera person. A lot of people that went through the program were, you know, doing video production and so forth. But she was in front of the camera. And she got an internship at Turner Broadcasting. And that was quite a few years ago. My understanding was she got a job there later. This is a young lady who, and she, I remember her telling me, she said, you know, when she went to Turner for her internship, she saw a lot of college graduates and young people who were considerably older than she. And she said things to me like, they didn't even know you're supposed to make eye contact when you and shake people's hands. They didn't know how to behave appropriately in a business environment. And she absolutely was prepared for that. So she was pretty amazing. And then there was another student, and I think there are probably lots of examples like this, but one of the things that's quite interesting about this program is that if you, let's say as a 15 or 16 or 17-year-old, have a chance to work somewhere where you thought, oh, I want to be a dental assistant or whatever, and you get a chance to do it, you can decide very early on, before you even out of high school, that, oh, maybe I was wrong about that. And I remember at least one student who told me that she really thought she wanted to be a dental assistant, but then she decided she didn't want to. And so saved her a lot of time. So there were a lot of students like this, but they were engaged. And I have to say, I've been into high schools and over the years, I've had three children that were in high school and so forth. And I'm used to going into high school where you see a lot of these young people who sort of look a little bit just like they're not all that into things. These kids, they were full on. They were pursuing their interests. They were engaged big time. Now, I've got some resources here, and either here or in the recording that you'll get after we post it, those QR codes will take you to these places. But the CEC has a channel with a bunch of stuff on YouTube, so that URL will get you there. They also, and I don't know if there's a newer version, but the current version that I saw, which was written quite a few years ago, there's a replication manual that if a community really wanted to take this on, here's a guide for how to do it. There's a bunch of videos. I just did a Google search for Mark Whitlock and the CEC, and so there's a bunch of other informational videos. This, the one next to the bottom there, is a Chamber of Commerce thing in Coweta County, and you get to see a sense of what the kinds of businesses are. And then there's a whole thing, a whole sort of framework that's thought of as accelerated careers. And that URL or that QR code will take you to a presentation that's on the CEC website. It's quite informative and interesting. Now, when we republish this book, I just want to give credit to these two people. Carol Harless, who was an extraordinary sculptress and was Joe's wife. After he passed, as I mentioned to you, she continued to sort of shepherd his work and his legacy and has continued to do so. But she's an amazing sculptress, but in any case, she was the person I contacted to get a copy of the book. And she said, you know, we don't have any more in stock. Is there any way we can find a place to republish it? And Rob Holsenbeck, who is still the Cambridge Center for Behavioral Studies executive director, I reached out to him because I'm on the board of advisors there and our trustees. And Rob was happy to collaborate with Carol, who helped fund a reprinting and publishing of it. So we now have the book. And if you want to get the book, you can go to EdenConspiracy.com, which is a little URL that we got, or you can use this QR code and it will take you to where you can buy it for a stunningly low price of $19.95. This I just wanted to show you because I think it's pretty cool. This is a kind of a relief that Carol created for the Technical College System of Georgia. And I just wanted to put it here to sort of honor Joe because his personal contributions to me, as well as all the technical stuff that he did and his vision for this was really amazing. A little bit of shameless commerce stuff to switch to our kind of our own work. We have our performance consulting certification program. We do an open version of it several times a year. The next one starts in January. You can use the QR code or look at performancethinking.com to get there. We have our free study guides for the webinars that you can get, that you can subscribe to. We also have a coaching program that we're trying to find an opportunity to pilot the newest version with a group of people who want to be certified. There are a few people in this list who I know are waiting for that, and I apologize. We've been delayed with it. Those are just sort of a few things I wanted to put in. But here's some takeaways, just to summarize. And then I think we'll have a few minutes to see if anybody has comments or questions. And in fact, you could even ask questions of Mark Whitlock, who knows a lot more than I do, and he's present with us. But, you know, Harless's work clearly evolved from the science of behavior. It's not some stuff that just got made up. It evolved through Tom Gilbert to Harless and to the work that's being done now. And accomplishment-based curriculum design focuses on the value that you deliver, the things that you deliver of value, whether you're in a job situation or as a citizen or as a student. I think the third bullet point is a really big deal. The third and fourth one, actually, are all these. One is that this thing was built on a community stakeholder needs analysis and engagement process. In other words, this was about what jobs, what requirements does our community have for employment, but also for just being a good citizen that we can help our young people achieve quickly. And one of the things I didn't mention, I should have mentioned this, these kids come out of high school and typically don't just have a high school diploma, they have an AA degree, and they may have one or more professional certifications. So these kids are launched way ahead of sort of their typical age accomplishments through this program. And so, and those accomplishments help to address what the community identified as the needs in the community and the businesses. I think this all demonstrates that instructional science or instructional design, when it's anchored in accomplishment, can enable learners, whether it's in an educational environment or business environment, to deliver value. And the last one is really just a restatement, but there's a lot of people, more and more people, who are very concerned about the state of education in America. And, you know, I happen to be a public broadcasting system, a PBS news junkie. I watch PBS News a lot, and they do many short bits on the state of American education, the state of kids, you know, educational debt, all the rest of it, the fact that we don't have skilled laborers, that you can actually make a lot of money, you can make a very good living in various ways that you don't have to go to college for if that's not your choice. In Germany, for example, there are paths, you know, you can become a very skilled, successful professional without going to college, or you can go to college in an academic direction. In fact, another thing I meant to mention was that through the various outreach and other things that the Central Education Center has done, we now have, I believe they have the first sort of fully approved, if you will, German apprenticeship model going on in the United States, which, as some of you may know, in Germany, that serves a really important societal purpose because it explicitly helps people become professionals in areas that that may not require a college education. And so this bottom point that if you want to do educational reform and you're frustrated by the fact that Congress or the Department of Education or whoever it is doesn't seem to be addressing this, think about this, a bottoms-up approach, because that's really what this was and what it represents and continues to be. So I want to open up the chat box here. It's open already. I haven't been looking at it as I've been going on and on. And I see there's a bunch of private messages. I would love it if people would make some of those public. I see a bunch of great notes from Mark. Wow. This one fellow is a social media executive for the Wall Street Journal. So the replication manual exists, as I mentioned to you. And wow, CEC helped to recruit to Noonan, an organization that will invest $2.57 billion to build storage batteries for, you know, the energy future. So that's amazing. Anyway, comments, questions. I've never, you know, one of the things is I've never used in this Webinar Jam platform had people speak. So Irwin is mentioning the Khan Academy, which does a good job. I haven't poked into Khan Academy for a long time. I sort of paid really close attention early on when it was formed, and I know there's a lot of good instructional stuff there. It looks like, from what you're saying, Irwin, that maybe it's beginning to think about sort of vocationally related training and skill sets too. So any comments or questions from people that, you know, we don't have to go to the full hour, but I wanted to be sure we had a chance to talk about this. What do you think? Does anybody think this represents a big deal? Because I sure do. I think it's a solution. I would like to encourage people to get the book and to pass it on to policymakers, to politicians, to business people in wherever it is that you live. Sue. Oh, good deal. Sue Riddle is here, who's from our local community college. She says, oh, they often have dual credit programs and programs in the trades. Yeah. So I think there's a lot of stuff around the country in the direction of where the CEC and Eden conspiracy have led us. What's stunning, though, is that Harless and people in Noonan, Georgia were talking about this stuff almost 30 years ago now, and in some ways the rest of the world is catching up, perhaps. Any other comments or questions people would like to add? All right, Abby's been trying to prime her community for 6 years. That's in Alaska. So Scott asks, and this is something that maybe Mark, you can respond to in a public to everybody message. You can see Scott asks, was the list of skills and knowledge information developed totally blank slate, or was it certain existing structure leveraged? I think it was probably driven a lot by the people they brought in and the companies that they were serving. But Mark, are you still with us? Can you maybe text a little response to Scott's question there? The impression that I had when I visited, and this was a few years ago, was that in many ways, it's easier to do accomplishment-based education when you're focused on a job. When you say a person who's trying to run factory automation or do welding or be a dental assistant, they have to produce certain things, and almost without being too explicit. So Mark is saying, originally developed by a steering committee. Yep. And then as it goes, it's my impression that the close relationships that you all have with, that is at the CEC, with the various businesses and with the placements in the businesses probably drives a lot of that. It's what do you need? I mean, the big accomplishment is a job, you know, a good job. And so then you back out of that and see what do people have to learn to be successful there. Irwin's comment about these kinds of things at vitallinkoc.org, learning about fields that you don't know anything about is a very interesting opportunity also. Well, I don't want to belabor this. We can certainly stop now. It's always a little bit challenging when chat is the primary way we interact, but I encourage you all to check out those links that I gave you earlier. When you get the recording, you'll be able to do that. Okay, there you go. Mark says businesses participate in various ways to update and change about what's needed. It makes perfect sense because it's got to be a moving target given things like batteries and such. I think the answer is no, Scott. I'm not sure what the current state of instructional methodologies are there. I've talked, you know, I think when I was visiting, and this is a few years ago now, this is like 5-6 years ago, we did talk a little bit about that, but I've been busy doing other things, I have to say. But kids were learning how to do stuff. That was this striking thing. And, you know, I sat in on a few classes. I talked to the video people in the video program, for example, and they were excited. They were producing documentaries and so forth. So Alexander says competency-based training on there. Yeah, now I have problems with competencies, Alexander. I'm not sure what that means. But if competencies are generally or abstract descriptions of behavior, I'm not a big fan. I would rather go to actual accomplishments, but fair enough. That's great, though. You knew Tom and Marilyn. Kate has got a good point. I'm sure there's a risk, although if you have people that are actually working on site, and if you have a close ongoing relationship, my bet is that businesses and the education system can sort that out somewhat. What I should have done, had I thought about it, was I should have reached out to see if Mark could co-facilitate a thing with me so that he could tell us more, because maybe we should have a follow-up. Actually, I think it would be kind of cool for the same audience to have a little bit more access to the CEO of this program. Anyway, I think we're done. I don't want to take any more of your time. The recording will be available within 48 hours. You'll get an email about it. But if you don't, or if you miss the email in your inbox, today's Wednesday, by Friday at the latest, if you go to our YouTube channel at performancethinking.tv, you'll be able to get the recording. And you can review it. You can grab some of those links and QR codes, and you can pass it on to your friends. Yeah, fair enough, Alexander. I appreciate that. I just try to avoid that word because I think competency models have been the worst thing you can do in training and education. And so a lot of times people mean that, but fair enough. I get your point. All right. Thank you, everyone. I think we're done for today.